Day weekend. We're glad that you chose to be here this morning, those of you who are here and joining us online. We thank you for being here today. Let's stand together as we begin in worship of our team this morning and sing it together.
Those of you who know who I am already, you know it's going to be a relatively short sermon, so you're going to get to lunch early. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Brother Austin. I'm a student pastor here at the church. Thank you very much for allowing me the privilege to be with you today. A couple of announcements to go over. If you haven't been in the board, I'm all the highlights of the couple. We do have super kids coming up. I would be able to qualify for that. It goes from, I think, from what, 7th grade to 6th. Go ahead and talk to Ms. Don about that if you have not already, if you want the students to go. Also, next Sunday, we are recognizing our graduates. So if you would like your graduates to be recognized, please contact me. My number is on the board. I would hate for someone not to be recognized. It's always my biggest fear coming here. I always drive you crazy. But please make sure to let me know if you have a graduate that you'd like to recognize and talk to someone. So, just like that. We're glad you're here. I'll go ahead and pray, and then Andrew will continue to lead us in worship. Father God, thank you so much for the privilege we have to come to worship you. God, I would ask that you would help us to put away our distractions around us, put away the outside world with, help us to make today by now, God, you. Help us to hear from you, Lord. Help us to love you.
Indeed, let's continue to bring him praise as we sing this one. Your love awakens me. We hope that is true of you this morning, that the love of God is what awakens us each and every day. We have so much to be thankful for in Him because He alone is God. We're going to continue to praise His name as we sing that now. Let's sing together. Your prayer this morning as well. We're going to read from Philippians chapter 2 this morning as we continue in our worship. And in this, the author is speaking of imitating Christ's humility. And we're going to pick up in verse 5 of chapter 2 in Philippians. It says this: in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Will you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father God, we thank you. Indeed, there is no other name but the name of Jesus Christ with the power to save. What a beautiful name it is. We give you thanks and praise. And we ask this morning, if there's someone here today who has not submitted their life to you, Father, they would not wait, they would not hesitate, that they would do so, that they would experience your love, your forgiveness, your mercy, and your joy. It's in your precious holy name we pray. Amen. I stand together. If you'll follow this land, let me see you. Wonderful, beautiful God, and we submit all that we are, all that we have, unto you. In the name of Jesus.
We're going to be reading from the book of Mark today. If you would, go ahead and turn to Mark chapter 8, verses 27 through 38. Forgive me, my eyes are making a copy of it today. It's not a big bad one. It's a bad one, but it's really just going to give the sound guys pretty accurate. It's really going to be on top of it. I'll give you a moment to turn there. Once you get there, go ahead and say words so I know I can continue. A long time ago on Facebook, I remember a story circulating. And whether it's true or not, I can't verify, but the thought behind today, I operated on a little girl. She needed O negative blood. We didn't have any, but her twin brother has O negative blood. I explained to him that it was a matter of life and death. That's why it was done. Said goodbye with parents. I didn't think anything of it until after he took his blood. And then he asked, okay, so when am I going to die? He thought, getting his life for her. Thankfully, they'll both be okay. Cute little example of someone being selfish. Someone will say denying self, which is what we're going to be talking about today in a bit. So I'll go ahead and start reading. Again, Mark chapter 8. I'm going to read the entirety of 27 through 38, and then we will begin. And Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? And they told him, John the Baptist. And others say, Elijah. And others, one of the prophets. And he asked them, but who do you say that I am? Peter answered him, you are the Christ. And he strictly charged them to tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said this plainly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are not saving things on God, but on things of man. In calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in my commit adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his So a lot just was said there in that short amount of time, and I'd like to go ahead and unpack that for a moment, if you don't mind. I'm going to go ahead, I know that a lot of you might be a little stressed out because I didn't see you in outline. I know that some of you are note takers. I do that on purpose because I'm reading. But I will go ahead and give you point one. Okay, that way you can go ahead and write it down. And you know, point one is Peter recognizes Jesus as the Messiah. I can go ahead and write that down. Peter recognizes Jesus. that's where we're starting off. So verses 27 through 30, and Jesus went on with his disciples, and he goes up to Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they told him, "John the Baptist, others, and others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Christ." And he strictly charged them to tell no one about him. A little bit more context, I'm going to go ahead and turn to Matthew 16. You don't have to. I'm going to turn to Matthew 16 to give us a little bit more detail of what's going on. It's important in context, and I'll explain why in a moment. But Matthew 16 tells us, Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, my Father who is in heaven." That's what I want to focus on here for a moment. Peter did not figure out on his own that Christ was his Son. You would think he would have, but he could have, rather, because he just witnessed Jesus feed thousands of people. He has witnessed Jesus still heal people. He has witnessed Jesus walk on water. He has witnessed Jesus raise people from the dead. He has witnessed Jesus cast out demons. So you could try to make God the world. That's not what happened. God revealed that to Peter. And that's an important distinction, because what that shows us is that Peter at this point in his life is walking in the Spirit, living in the Spirit. He is sensitive to the Spirit of God. He is hearing, understanding, learning, whatever you want to call it, from God. Nobody understand that so far. That's important because of what happens to Peter. So real quick, we're going to go into something else before that. Peter is walking in the Spirit. He gets his knowledge from God. He proclaims it. And now, number two, very simple. Very simple. Jesus verifies it. Jesus verifies that. If you go back to Matthew 16, Jesus says, "And Jesus answered him, 'Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven.'" So Peter, through the Spirit of God, says, "You are the Messiah." And Jesus looks at him and says, "Yes, I am." And that is verification that I am, in fact, the Messiah. Why is it important, you think, to know that Peter understands that Christ is the Messiah? Because he's speaking, we have to need to understand what that means for Peter. Because we need to understand what the Jews look at the Messiah as. And this is important. It gives more context to what's about to happen. I'm going to turn to Isaiah chapter 2. You do not have to. And don't worry, I won't read the title of this. I'm going to read a whole lot. I'm going to read a lot. So I'm reading Isaiah chapter 2. I'm reading the first 5 verses. Okay? At the context, if you've ever read Isaiah, you'll notice that it's kind of tricky. There's a prophet who kind of prophesied different timelines, different time frames. At this point, he's prophesying about the time when Jesus will come and reign. This is the Messiah that the Jews are thinking about. This is the Messiah that Peter is thinking about. The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem, it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. It shall be lifted up above the hills, and all the nations shall flow to it. Many people shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, he shall decide disputes for many people. He shall, people that shall beat their swords into plowshares, their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up swords against nations, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord." So that's who Peter believes Jesus is. Jesus is this person who has come, who is going to end up eventually conquering Rome, because that's a lot of what Jesus is, and then eventually conquering the world. And the whole world will be submitted under the rule. Is that going to happen? know, biblically speaking, that is going to happen. But that's not the Jesus Christ that we see yet. Right? But that's what Peter believes. That's what he's proclaiming, right? You are the Messiah. People will come to you for rule. People will come to you for wisdom. People will submit to you who will rule the world. It will be so great that there won't even be war anymore. That's who Peter believes Jesus is. That is his proclamation. And Jesus says, yes, that is who I am. I am the Messiah. You all have that in our head so far? Okay. So again, Peter recognizes Jesus Christ, those who rule this world, that every nation will submit to, every person will learn from. That is who he is just proclaimed Christ as. Now I'm going to give you your second highlight point. Jesus is Jesus Peter. In this context, Peter proclaims Jesus as the Messiah. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the priests and the scribes and the kids. Just 3 days right again. And he said this plainly. In other words, this wasn't a parable. This wasn't him trying to be mysterious. He was plainly looking at his and saying, I'm going to die, and in 3 days I'm going to rise again. Very funny, very upfront. And here's the reaction. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Now, I know that several of us have read over the story before. We know what happened. But I want you to understand and kind of think about what just happened. Peter just proclaimed that Jesus was the Messiah, that he was above everything. He was going to rule the world. People were going to come to him for wisdom, come to him for law. And in the same breath, you're wrong about that. No, seriously. Literally, you're going to know everything, and everyone's going to learn everything from you. But Jesus, you're wrong about that. Same breath. Living by the Spirit, living by the flesh. That quick. That quick. So Jesus rebuked him. Remember, Jesus just got done recognizing that Jesus was the Messiah. He just got done hearing from a Spirit-led moment. He was living in the Spirit. And it that quickly was sitting in the flesh. And we'll try to focus on the flesh. That quickly. Now, how could Peter go from you're the Messiah, everyone will submit to you, everyone will come to you for law, everyone will come to learn from you? Well, you're right about that. Because if you really, again, you've got to think about how crazy that is. The example I gave in the first service was that I went to your house a couple times to remind them about my father and my mom. I wanted to make sure I was there. Possible on earth, I want to know how to see it properly. I want to know how to jump safety, and I know that I think Jerry was certified. Well, I don't think it happened. I'm just certified here. You went over there, right? That's my point. If you're, I don't know that. I know that you know all this, so please teach me. Now imagine if I got there, and then Jerry started telling me things. I looked at Jerry, and I was like, well, I think you're wrong about this. I know you have all this experience. I know I came to you, but I think you're wrong. Kind of silly, kind of foolish, and that's where Peter is. But how can he get there? Simply by focusing on himself in that moment. By focusing on himself in that moment. Peter was right about Christ. So of course, how he felt in that moment had to be right as well. He just got fucked up. He just said, you're the Son of God. And Christ said, yes, you're right. So, of course, Peter must have been feeling like, oh, man, awesome. He's the Son of God. I know everything. He just pumped me up. And that was Jesus. I don't feel like you're being right about this. He focused on how he feels in that moment. What Peter failed to consider was just from the Peter loved him. Of course he didn't want him to die. He just simply didn't understand. Instead of listening to what he was saying, he said, by this person, he was a follower. He was only focused on what he wanted. What did Paul say? How can you be so arrogant to recognize Jesus is the Messiah and the same breath try to correct the Messiah? It's true. But how often do you and I both do the same thing? So say, God, you're right about this. Or maybe you say, oh, how that sermon was on point. God spoke me through that. You know what I need to do? And then you walk out the door, life happens, and they went out there. And you start focusing on and this brings me to my third point, and we're going to be here, I think, for the next few minutes. My third point, Jesus is the solution. And I'm going to try to extend that. Jesus is the solution to the human dilemma. Like the human dilemma of how can we possibly be the solution? How can we possibly be the solution? And calling the crowd to him with his disciples. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Very simple. Let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. But see, I want to take it a little bit further there. Not further, I want to expound on that a little bit more. Because I think that it's really true. It is true that we should deny ourselves. We all know that, but I want to explain what that means. It's very easy. Pastor, or teacher, or whatever, say, well, just deny yourself. Okay, go on. Now you know. But I'd like to explain what it means to deny yourself. I think it's very important. Now, the Greek word there, use, I'm not going to pronounce it because I can't. So it says to forget oneself, to lose sight of oneself, and one's own interest. Now, to lose sight of oneself and one's own interest. I'm going to give you the off in the bridge version. I would like to say, you put what God says over how you feel in the moment. Okay? So you put what God says over how you feel in the moment. Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is a deceitful thing above all things. And desperately sick. Who can understand it? Not that it can be. Not that it's so much. No. It is deceitful above all things. So what does that mean? Quite simply, that means that your heart can lie to you quite a bit. Quite simply put, that means that how you feel in the moment might not be quite true. I used to be driven by my emotions and not. And it was unfortunate to me that people who knew me at that point in my life. And I love God. But I was so unaware of how much I would control my heart and my mind. It's very easy to understand that I'm missing something. And this is what's happening to me right now. Have you ever been controlled by how you felt in the moment, even though you knew that that's not what God wanted to happen or wanted you to do? So I'll be honest, the answer is yes. Look at Peter as an example. I'm not beating up on Peter again. Peter had some great moments in the Bible. He walked on water. He preached to thousands of people. Great moments in the Bible. He knows where the pillars in the church. Peter also has some things. But what I want us to focus on is what was he focused on in the midst of those things? What was Peter focused on? He felt fear about the waves and how high they were. Focused on how he felt. He was focused on how he felt when he heard that Jesus was going to die. He focused on how he felt when he cut off his large ear. He was focused on how he felt, that he denied Jesus not once, but three times. Knowing Jesus. Knowing who Jesus was. Focused on how he felt in the moment. And then this one, to me, a lot of people would say this is like the smallest one, but to me, this is the most telling of how the world views people are. How he felt when he would not eat with the Gentiles in the physical nature. For those of you who don't know, especially, Peter would not eat with the Gentiles. He would not sit down and eat with them in the physical nature because he was worried that other people would criticize him for it. He was worried people would get upset. Killer of the church, one of Jesus' great disciples, was worried about peer pressure. He gave him to how he felt in that moment. Think about how silly that is, but also how powerful that is. This man, led by the Spirit, priest in his eyes, by the Spirit. How easily can we fall into the focus on how we feel? The reason I think that last one is the most poignant and powerful, whatever you want to say, is because I think that's what we all feel. That's a small one. Well, I don't want to think of it. I don't want to think of it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to look at my sin. Oh, what God says to do, what God says to do. Again, this is not a condemnation of people. I'm just using him as an example of how easily we as people can go from getting it right to getting it so wrong. The Bible is full. It's full of heroes of the faith who, in one moment, are living for Christ, and in the next, are completely focused on how they feel. Just to name a few, Moses. A great man of God, yes? Absolutely. Absolutely. From Moses' failure, God says, talk to that rock. Moses thought it made sense. See? So he gets the rock. Because of this, he can no longer see the promise. What about David? What's the first thing you learn about David? First thing, just like I thought before, first thing you learned about David's life. Goliath. 14-year-old shepherd boy. Fights the most fearsome warrior of Israel. A giant so large and so strong and so deadly that all these grown warriors are afraid of. David walks up and grabs this man. He literally says, I'm going to kill you because God said so. Because he was focused on what he knew. He was focused on what he knew. But take the same person, now a man, arguably more mature, maybe farther along in his faith at this point in time, goes out on the balcony and sees a woman that he wants. And in that moment, I think I want that. No longer walking in the Spirit, no longer focusing on things of God, but focusing on what David wants, how he felt. Because of this, he had the husband off the town, all the cover of life. This baby now dies to go on. He paid dearly for acting on how he felt in that moment. How long do you think he stood there? And this is purely speculation. How long do you think it took him to make that decision? How long? I almost imagine it wasn't that quick. And it wasn't that long. I imagine he didn't sit there much. The longer, to me, the longer I feel the same, the longer I'm not going to have to. Right? Oftentimes, if I'm angry now, I just feel angry. I take a step back and I say, well, why am I angry? Okay, this is about me. Okay, I'm going to do stupid. Okay, get over it. Right? You just have to do that. Made a decision that's a hundred percent. He kind of used to it. That day your feelings are valid. I'm not saying it's bad. Okay? I'm not saying that I love my son. I love that my son is cute. But I'm not saying they're bad. I love my son. But does that mean I need to deny myself and not hang out with my son? No. It simply means my life is not dictated on how I feel at the moment. Right? Our life as Christians should not be dictated on how we feel at the moment. I'm going to give you a really silly example. Ladies, raise your hand if you have ever been so angry at your husband that you just want to smack him up out of the way. I knew this was going to be. Did you? I hope not. Say again. Hey, again, you're not being controlled by your emotions. Thank God we're not, because I would be up here beating and bruised, because I deserve it. Chelsea has to deal with me on a daily basis. One thing I do, ladies, I'll tell you this right now. One thing I do is that Chelsea has a in my mind, at the time, starts. Right? And as soon as that time is up, that's the weekend. And I'm going for it. That's a few days ago. And I'm telling you, she has a nice truth sometimes. And that's seriously, man. That's the weekend. That's the time at all. 24 hours is hot. Thank the Lord for it. We don't act on our emotions all the time. Thank the Lord that we're not driven by that. Another great example of not being driven by how you feel. Christ says here to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him. The awesome thing about Christ is he never commands you and tells you to do something that he doesn't already know himself. It surprises you to know that Jesus did not want to go to the cross. On the contrary, Jesus asked his Father to take it from him. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you. Christ, you're wrong. You are surely not going to die. You're surely not going to die. No, Christ is not going to happen. I won't let it." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, but you are not setting your mind things of God. Now, some of your translations might say you are stumbling blocks. But Jesus is saying that, by the way, the sake of the name of the there, that's the Hebrew word that means skin. There are long moves, the most common conversation is your skin. In other words, here, you are being an adversary to me right now. You're being an enemy to me right now. You are tempting me. You are being a stumbling block to me. Jesus knew he had to die. He knew he had to go to the cross as what God sent him to his church to do. Jesus and his humanity did not want to go. Because he knew about the suffering. Go into the garden. Here's the three slogans. Really trying to understand how he feels in that moment. You can feel yourself. You can feel it. But focusing on how you feel in the moment. But by focusing on what you know, by focusing on the Lord, by focusing on His Word, it will get into your heart and receive everything you want. But we oftentimes think in our minds that to be angry is to be sinful. Why is that? It's because oftentimes when we are angry, we are sinful. But is that simply just because we're getting into our heart? So real quick, in closing, I want to change the lane a bit. I want to get away from talking to Christians, and I want to get to talking to everyone. Okay? Because right now we're talking to Christians about living in the Spirit, and now we're talking to everyone. think about what he asked the disciples to do. And this is not for me, this is pointing out to me, this is someone much wiser than me. Earlier, Jesus asked the disciples, what do people say that I am? Well, what do people say? But notice here, there's no mention. It's super easy, it's super common to say that Jesus is Lord, to say that Jesus is Messiah. It's not super common for people to actually follow that. Because we have a, here in America, we have a concept of salvation, where we think that Jesus is the Messiah, is the Lord, and the deny yourself and your father and give your life to them. That is what it means something. Look here, Joseph Berman says, for whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life will not save it, and the gospel will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world or to his soul? I think that might be something like it. But what can a man give? Talk about the doing here. I'm not talking about you don't follow this list. You have this criteria. You have this criteria. If you want, I can just use one of these. You have this criteria that you must follow, this list that you got to check off, and then God says, okay, bud, you've done X, Y, Z, you're good. You've earned it. That's not what Christ is saying here. And that's why he says right here, what can a man give in return for his soul? A pastor I used to serve under used to say, you are spiritually bankrupt. In other words, there is a debt that you are never going to be able to pay. How in the world can you think that you're going to be able to buy your soul back? How can you earn your salvation? You can't. You are spiritually bankrupt. That is why it is important that we follow Christ and allow Him to do it. That is what it means. Take up your cross and follow Him. It means you submit to Christ as your Lord, big L, and Savior. That big L is important. It means you submit to Him. It means He is the boss of your life. That means deny yourself. That means no longer being focused on how you feel in the moment, but being focused on what God says in the moment. Again, to be focused on self. To act on only on how you feel in the moment is very human. That is who you are. Very human. But to act on spirit, to act on what God says to do, it's very spirit led, it's very powerful. But two things, and in closing, if you are a child of God, I will implore you to make sure you are living by the Spirit. Again, I was a Christian when I was an extremely emotional being. I was a Christian when I was allowing how I felt to dictate what I did and how I did it. I was insane. I thought, you do not want to know often if you're like that. Really, honestly, it's really embarrassing that there are people alive in this world that knew me then. Like, I wish that I could just talk to strangers and just wipe them in. Right? That's what I want to do. But it's better for them to see who I was then and who I am now because of what God has done. If you're not a believer, if you have not submitted your life to Christ, I implore you, give your life to Christ. Thank you everyone for being here this weekend. I'm here to play Memorial Day. I would like to apologize. I know I told you this in the story, but I'm here to talk and I have a lot of my mom. I've been very hungry, but I'm kind of with me and I'm not. Father God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for your son. Thank you for the example that Christ gives us.
Sing together as we close. Thank you for being here this morning.